Okay. All right, this evening, already told you what we're going to be doing. We're going to be looking at heaven, and what I thought we would do is read a passage of Scripture that doesn't necessarily tell us what heaven is like, but expresses that desire, the desire of somebody who knew and who could see perhaps much more clearly than we can what heaven is like and who desire to be there. And that's the testimony of the Apostle Paul to the Philippian church. And he gives it to us basically in verses 21 through 23, but I'd like to begin reading in verse 12 through the end of the chapter. This is what Paul writes again by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit. He says, "Now I want you to know, brethren, that my circumstances have turned out for the greater progress of the gospel, so that my imprisonment in the cause of Christ has become well known throughout the whole Praetorian Guard and to everyone else, and that most of the brethren, trusting in the Lord because of my imprisonment, have far more courage to speak the word of God without fear. Some, to be sure, are preaching Christ even from envy and strife, but some also from goodwill. The latter do it out of love, knowing that I am appointed for the defense of the gospel. The former proclaim Christ out of selfish ambition rather than from pure motives, thinking to cause me distress in my imprisonment. What then? Only that in every way, whether in pretense or in truth, Christ is proclaimed, and in this I rejoice. Yes, and I will rejoice, for I know that this will turn out for my deliverance through your prayers and the provision of the Spirit of Jesus Christ, according to my earnest expectation and hope, that I will not be put to shame in anything, but that with all boldness Christ will even now, as always, be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. For to me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. But if I am to live on in the flesh, this will mean fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which to choose. But I am hard-pressed from both directions, having the desire to depart and be with Christ, for that is very much better. Yet to remain on in the flesh is more necessary for your sake. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with you all for your progress and joy in the faith, so that your proud confidence in me may abound in Christ Jesus through my coming to you again. Only conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or remain absent, I will hear of you that you are standing firm in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel, in no way alarmed by your opponents, which is a sign of destruction for them, but of salvation for you, and that too from God. For to you it has been granted for Christ's sake, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, experiencing the same conflict which you saw in me, and now here to be in me." May the Lord bless his word as we are thinking about, you know, sharing Christ with others and the opposition that we have to face. We do need to realize the Apostle Paul had to face opposition, but he was willing to do it. He was willing even to go to prison. And in prison, he continued to share the gospel. You know, you might think when you're imprisoned by the enemies of Christ that you might hush up to make things easier on yourself, but he didn't. He continued to proclaim Christ to the others, and that many of the Praetorian Guard actually came to faith in Jesus through his witnessing to them. And of course we see that he's encouraging the church in Philippi, who were encouraged by the fact that he was willing to take this stand, to do the same thing. Suffering is a part of the Christian life, and it comes, of course, through making Jesus known to others, which is what the Lord calls us to do. But again, Paul in this situation is having the hope and the expectation that he's going to be released from prison and that he is going to come to them. He has that hope. And yet he also has the hope that he's going to be with the Lord, and he's struggling between these two things, whether to remain on and continue to serve Jesus or to depart and to be with Christ. But what we want to see is that the second option is very much better. And the reason is because he will be with Christ. Jesus, Father, Son, Holy Spirit, is what makes heaven to be heaven. And that's what we need to focus on this evening. That's primarily what we're going to be looking at. Now, just by way of review this morning, remember Peter told us that as believers, we can not only have joy, but we can have joy inexpressible that words really can't describe, a joy that is full of glory, knowing that the Lord has saved us, knowing that He is working to make everything that happens in our lives conspire together to bring us to heaven, where we will be able to enjoy Him forever. Now, when we put the kingdom first in our lives, as we saw this morning, it strengthens not the reality of this truth. I mean, it's true objectively, apart from our apprehension of it, apart from what we see or believe, it's true. But when we put the kingdom first, it strengthens our ability to be able to perceive it and to believe it and to have the assurance that it is ours. We can only have this joy that Peter is referring to when we know that what we want most will be ours. It's the Spirit that gives us this conviction, and the Spirit will only give us this conviction when we devote ourselves completely to Him, when we put the kingdom of heaven first, when we put the Lord first, when we devote ourselves to Him. Now, if having the hope of these things will bring us the kind of joy that Peter described this morning, how much greater will it be when we actually have those things? Now, that's really what we want to look at this evening. I've already told you in our passage, we see that Paul found the joy that Peter was referring to in our text this morning in serving his Lord here, in devoting his life to Him here. He says, for him to live is Christ. And what he means, of course, is while he's alive, he's going to serve Christ, but his whole purpose in life was serving the Lord, to continue on in this world, to live for Him, to work for Him, to further His kingdom. That is what brought him the greatest happiness. And yet, he says, to die is gain. To depart and be with Christ would be not just better or much better, but very much better. So what we want to look at this evening is why heaven is so much better than what we have here on earth. And I realize it's kind of a ridiculous question, but we do want to at least think about the things that are there. What can we expect to receive in heaven? What can we expect to see in heaven that is so much more glorious than what we have here in this world? Because if it is much more glorious, we shouldn't be so much hanging on to this world, hanging on to life here, but rather have the attitude that Paul had to want to leave and to be with Jesus. Well, of course, it's so much better there, first of all, because of who is there, and that's the one thing that Paul was referring to depart and to be with Christ is very much better. The one we love the most, by the grace of God, is there. The Father is there in all of His glory. You know, the one who loved us, the one who chose us to be His, the one who sent His Son for us so that we might be with Him. He is there expressing all of that love towards those He has loved, toward us, whom He has loved from all eternity. The Son is there in all of His glory, the one who also loved us and who left heaven to become one with us, to endure man's hatred against Himself, to go to the cross to save us from our sins so that He might have us as His own forever. He is there, seated at the right hand of the Father in all of His glory, expressing all of His love. And of course, the Spirit is there in all of His glory and His fullness. The one who loved us, the one who came to us, the one who made us alive when we were dead, who guided us, comforted us, and strengthened us throughout our lives so that He might present us to the Son. He is there in all of His glory, expressing all of His love and filling His people with love. Now, when we arrive in heaven, we will see them, and we will see them in all of their glory. We won't see them, interestingly, with our physical eyes, because our physical eyes are going to be left here on earth. We're only going to be disembodied spirits, but we will see them with the eyes of our souls. We will see their glory and bask in their love. I'm going to give you a few quotes this evening, and I believe, for the most part, they come from the Puritans who thought very deeply about these things. The first quote comes from Ezekiel Hopkins. He writes that heaven is where the unveiled glories of the deity shall beat full upon us, and we forever sun ourselves in the smiles of God. They had a way with words that is unique. By the way, I emphasize the fact that we're going to see them with the eyes of our souls, not only because we won't have our physical eyes when we actually are there in heaven, provided, of course, the Lord doesn't come and bring about the end of all things before we die and go to be with Him, because our experience there at that time is going to be different than when we actually do have our resurrected bodies and get to see the Lord with our eyes. We're going to focus on that when we get to the new heavens and the new earth. So what Paul desired more than anything else, and what we hope for and long for, will finally be realized in heaven. We will get to see them as they are. Now, we should also note, although it's not our primary source of joy, but certainly will be a source of joy, that we're going to see others there as well that are also going to bring us joy. Obviously, we're going to see the holy angels, the host that God created to serve us, the chosen angels, the elect angels that Paul writes to Timothy about in 1 Timothy 5:21, the ones that he preserved from falling away in heaven when Lucifer rebelled, the ones he preserved that they might help us make it safely to heaven, we will also get to see them. As a matter of fact, we know from what Scripture tells us that they have been interacting with us throughout our entire lives. So they know us, even though we don't know them so much, but we will get to know them there. We're also going to see our brothers and sisters, the ones who have gone before us, the ones that the Lord also saved from their sins, the ones who are now perfected in holiness. The author to the Hebrews writes in Hebrews 12, verses 22 through 24, "But you have come to Mount Zion and to the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to myriads of angels, to the general assembly and church of the firstborn who were enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood, which speaks better than the blood of Abel." Basically, the author to the Hebrews wraps up everything we've just looked at to this point. We're going to have the joy of remembering each other. Those of us who are here now, one day we're going to move our fellowship, as it were. We're going to be removed to heaven. And we will remember the things that we did together for the glory of God, and we will rejoice in those things. We will also see and recognize the saints that we've read about and the ones that we have so long admired, and we all have different, perhaps, favorites: Luther, Calvin, Jonathan Edwards, George Whitfield, Charles Spurgeon, and a host of others. We're also going to be able to see saints that we've never even heard of, and yet we will know them. Thomas Watson writes, "Some have asked whether we shall know one another in heaven. Surely our knowledge will not be diminished, but increased. The judgment of Luther and Anselm and many other divines is that we shall know one another. Yes, the saints of all ages, whose faces we never saw, and when we shall see the saints in glory without their infirmities of pride and passion, it will be a glorious sight." That's one thing I really hadn't thought about. You know, that we're going to see, I mean, we are going to see people, like that part we know, that we've never known and we've never even thought of, never heard their names, but when we see them, we will know them. And we'll know something of what they did for the Lord's glory. In heaven, there's no longer going to be any divisions between any of the people of God. Luther, when he sees you and me, he is going to be able to embrace us as brethren. If you know anything about the history of Luther, you know that people that didn't agree with him on the Lord's Supper, he had a difficult time accepting as Christians. Well, he's going to embrace us even though we didn't necessarily agree with this teaching on the Lord's Supper, because all the divisions are going to be broken down. John Wesley and Augustus Toplady are both now with the Lord in heaven, and instead of being opponents to one another, they love and receive one another as brethren, even though they did differ here on earth regarding how the Lord brings people to faith. Now, I should just stop and mention here the fact that all who trust in the Lord Jesus are going to be there and are going to spend eternity together with the Lord, that should make us careful how we treat those who differ with us here on earth. If we're trusting Jesus, we're brothers. We're family now, even though we may differ with one another in certain areas. Now, we realize that there are certain truths we can't waver on that define what a Christian is. But if we embrace those truths, and if we embrace the Savior, who's basically the center of those truths, then we are saved and we are brethren in the Lord. And we do need to remember that, even though we may differ with one another in other areas. There, we're also going to be able to love one another more deeply than we are able to do it here on earth because of our sin and weakness, but also because there we're going to be filled with the Spirit of God beyond anything we've experienced here. Here we only have a down payment. We have, you know, just a taste of heaven and of that joy that we'll receive. We have just a small part of that love with which we'll be able to love. There we'll be filled with that love and that joy and peace and patience. There's no longer going to be any envy, no competition, no hatred, nothing but pure love and affection for one another. So again, we will be able to see the Lord in all of His glory, and we'll also be able to enjoy this kind of fellowship that we have never up to this point really done anything beyond just, as it were, a taste of that. We only have shadows here. There we have the reality. There, all of our needs are going to be met. The only thing that's going to be missing, of course, is that which we won't miss, and that is sin. Edward Willen writes, "In heaven, they," that is those who are in heaven, "are free from want," that is from the lack of anything. They can want nothing there unless it be want itself. They may find the want of evil, but never feel the evil of want. In other words, the Lord will provide fully. No more pain, no more suffering, no more death, so no more reason to be sad, no more reason to weep, no more reason to mourn. This passage from Isaiah sums it up, Isaiah 25:8. "He will swallow up death for all time, and the Lord God will wipe tears away from all faces, and He will remove the reproach of His people from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken." Sounds like a glorious place. Now, the fact that we had to endure what we've had to endure on earth is going to make heaven even better. You know how it is when you move from the fire, you know, you come out of the suffering into this place of joy instead of just moving from joy to joy, as it were, and there is a certain sense in which we're doing that. But we're moving from persecution, tribulation, to a place where all that's removed and there's just pure joy and happiness. The fact that we went through those things here will make heaven even better. Thomas Adams writes this, "He that will be knighted must kneel for it, and he that will enter in at the strait gate must crowd for it. A gate made so on purpose, narrow and hard in the entrance, yet, after we have entered, wide and glorious, that after our pain, our joy may be the sweeter." Thomas Adams is kind of known as the Shakespeare of the Puritans. He has, a way with words, but makes it so concrete. Difficult here, but when we get there, so glorious, and the difficulty makes it even better. Here, there is always something to spoil our happiness, but there, nothing can spoil it. I read this once before, but I wanted to read it again. Jonathan Edwards tells us that God makes it that way on purpose. for our happiness not to be complete here, so that we'll look forward to heaven. Now, I do have a couple of quotes by Edwards. This is one of my more lengthy ones, so you try to follow along. I'll try to read it in a way that will hopefully make it as comprehensible as possible. These quotes don't come out of his sermons, although if they did, they'd probably be just as difficult to understand, but they come out of his miscellanies, and these were just things that he thought of and wanted to capture in writing before it got away from him, and he never actually wrote these things for public reading. He wrote these things for his own benefit, although sometimes he would take what he wrote and just take the whole thing and just put it word for word in his sermons. Like I said, the sermons aren't necessarily that much easier, but let me just read what he has to say and follow what he's saying here. He says, "It has sometimes looked strange to me that men should be ever brought to such exceeding happiness as that of heaven seems to be, because we find that here providence, or the way God arranges things, will not suffer or allow any great degree of happiness. When men have something in which they hope to find very great joy, there will be something to spoil it." By the way, we did talk about the fact that whatever joy we have down here always wears off. Here he's saying that God always mixes it with something to spoil it. Okay? "Providence seems watchfully to take care that they should have no exceeding joy and satisfaction in this world." That is, apart from the joy we have, of course, and knowing we're going to be there. "But indeed, this, instead of being one argument against the greatness of heaven's happiness, seems to argue for it. For we cannot suppose that the reason why providence will not allow men to enjoy great happiness here is that he is averse to the creature's happiness, but because this is not a time for it. To everything there is an appointed season and time, and this agreeable to God's method of dispensation, that a thing should be sought in vain out of its appointed time. God reserves happiness to be bestowed hereafter. That is the appointed time for it, and that is the reason he does not give it now. No man, let him be never so strong or wise, shall alter this divine establishment by anticipating happiness before his appointed time. It is so in all things. Sometimes there is an appointed time for man's prosperity upon earth, and then nothing can hinder his prosperity. And then, when that time is past, then comes an appointed time for his adversity. And then all things conspire for his ruin, and all his strength and skill shall not help him. History verifies this with respect to many kings, generals, and great men. One while they conquer all, and nothing can stand before them. All things conspire for their advancement, and all that oppose it are confounded. And after a while, it is right the reverse. So has it been with respect to the kingdoms and monarchies of the world. One while is their time to flourish, and then God will give all into their hands and will destroy those that oppose their flourishing. And then after that comes the time of their decay and ruin, and then everything runs backward, and all helpers are vain. God has his appointed time, and his appointed time is not now, beyond the anticipation of knowing what we're going to enjoy in heaven. The appointed time is when we get to heaven. So the fact that we don't enjoy that perfect happiness here doesn't mean we're not going to have it there. It's reserved for there. It's not for here. He says basically that's an argument for its perfection there. Heaven is where our happiness will be perfect, not mingled with anything to spoil it. Now, if this seems too good to be true, I do want to read one other quote by Edwards where he tells us this. I'll just give you the summary of it to begin with so we get his main point and then listen to how he unfolds it. A much shorter quote. "If God loved us so much that he was willing to give his son for us to make that kind of a payment in order to make us happy, the happiness that he bought for us through the price of his son must be great happiness." Now listen to what he says here. This is another miscellany. He says, "If nothing be too much to be given to man, and to be done for man in the means of procuring his happiness, nothing will be too much to be given to him as the end. No degree of happiness is too great for him to enjoy. When I think how great this happiness is, sometimes it is ready to seem almost incredible, unbelievable. But the death and sufferings of Christ make everything believable, make it credible that belongs to this blessedness. For if God would so contrive to show his love in the manner and means of procuring our happiness, nothing can be incredible in the degree of happiness itself. If all that God does about it be of a piece, he will also set infinite wisdom on work to make their happiness and glory great in the degree of it. Then here he quotes, I think you'll recognize this passage, "If God spared not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things?" Nothing could have been such a confirmation of their blessedness as this. The price that God pays for our happiness argues that that happiness must be as great as the payment, which is, of course, infinite happiness. So that's what we have looking forward, looking ahead of us into heaven, what we have to look forward to. But there is another stage to this happiness, and that is what happens when the Lord's plan for this world is finally over, and he brings in the new heavens and the new earth, and he brings us into that new place. There, our joy is going to be even greater because, well, I think the main reason is this, because we will enjoy it not only in our souls, but also in our bodies, which up to this point were still returning to dust in their graves. When we come into the new heavens and new earth, we will have our resurrection bodies. Now, for one thing, in the new heavens and the new earth, that takes place after the judgment. And at the judgment, we're going to be, as we've already read in the book of Jude, presented before the Lord blameless. No sin is going to be brought up against us. And praise the Lord for that mercy. But we're also going to be rewarded for the things that we've actually done for the Lord's glory in this world. We've been reminded of that numerous times. Now, those rewards, obviously, we're not going to be able to enjoy until we actually receive them. So we're going to receive them at the final judgment. We'll begin to enjoy them in the new heavens and the new earth. Now, what are those rewards? Now, that's the thing that perhaps there's a disagreement. I'm sure there's disagreement in the church, as there is on various, you know, invariably everything else. But it's likely not going to be those things that are often used to describe it in Scripture, because those things really only have value in this world. For instance, you know, the idea of crowns and gold and jewels and things of that nature. But rather, the ability to experience more of the happiness of this new world. This is the way that Thomas Watson describes it. And again, it's the way that Jonathan Edwards and really the Puritans as a whole saw these rewards. Thomas Watson writes this, "The more we grow in grace," and he's referring to here, "the more we shall flourish in glory, though every vessel of glory shall be full, yet some vessels hold more." Now, perhaps that'll make more sense when I read the next one. Daniel Caudray writes this, "Like as sundry vessels or various vessels, whereof some are bigger and some less, if they all be cast into the sea, some will receive more water and some less, and yet all shall be full, and no want in any. So likewise, among the saints of God in heaven, some shall have more glory, some less, and yet all, without exception, full of glory." So the way the Puritans described it is basically this. What we do on earth determines the size of our vessel, as it were, the size of the pot that is cast into this ocean of love. Every one of us is going to be submerged in the love of God, and we're all going to be filled with it to the fullness of our capacity. But some of us will have a larger capacity to enjoy it, as it were, even more, but nobody will suffer or think that they're missing out on anything because they're all full to the capacity. Everybody is full. So this is basically the way they viewed it. It's a larger capacity, a greater capacity to enjoy heaven. And what that's like is would really be difficult to understand. But I think we have some idea of what it's like in the world. Some people seem to be able to enjoy things more than we're able to enjoy, but everybody can enjoy to their ability, whatever that thing, may be. So, again, now we will also, and here's where we get into an area that I thought was very interesting. And again, words can only go so far, but I thought we'd take a crack at it. That's another quote by Edwards, because he was somebody who liked to think outside of the box. He didn't want to just say, okay, well, this is what Calvin says, and so that's as far as we go. But he tried to take what Scripture said and tried to understand it more deeply. And try to think along with him here. He talks here about the fact that we're going to experience certain things in heaven, or I should say, that's not what he's talking about here, but he's talking about the new heavens and the new earth. But there are going to be things we experience in heaven, joys, delights, glory, love, but we're going to experience it spiritually in our souls because we don't yet have our bodies. But in the new heavens and the new earth, we will have our resurrection bodies, and so we will have additional faculties, we'll have additional senses, and all of those senses are going to be delighted by the things that are taking place there. Now, that's kind of an interesting thought. So let's see how he writes this again, or how he explains it in this miscellany. He says this, as the saints, after the resurrection, will have an external part, that is a body, or an outward man, distinct from their souls, so it necessarily follows that they shall have external perception or sense, and doubtless then all their sense and all the perception that they will have will be delighted and filled with happiness. Every perceptive faculty shall be an inlet of delight. Particularly then, doubtless, they will have the seeing, which is the noblest of all the external senses. And then, without doubt, the most noble sense will receive most pleasure and delight. This sense will be immensely more perfect than it is now. And the external light of the heavenly world will be a perfectly different kind of light from the light of the sun or any light in this world, exciting sensations or ideas in the beholders perfectly different, of which we can no more conceive than we can conceive of a color we never saw, or than a blind man can conceive of light and colors, a sort of light immensely more pleasant and glorious, in comparison of which the sun is a shade and its light but darkness. And this world full of the light of the sun is a world under the darkness of night, but heaven is a world of light, affording inexpressible pleasure and delight to the beholders, immensely exceeding all sensitive delights in this world. That the light of heaven, which will be the light of the brightness of Christ's glorious body, shall be a perfectly different sort of light from that of this world seems evident from Revelation 21:11, and that it will be so and will also be ravishingly sweet to the eye is evident from the circumstances of Christ's transfiguration and also from the circumstances of Moses' vision of God in the mount. So as the disciples with their earthly eyes saw Christ transfigured and glorified and the effect that it had on them, and as Moses, as he begged God to see his glory, if I found favor in your sight, Lord, let me see your glory. God says, you can't see it and survive. So he says, I'll put you in the cleft of the rock. I'll pass by and you'll see my trailing parts. And when he saw that, he was blessed. Well, we get to see not just the trailing parts with our earthly eyes, but we get to see the full glory with our resurrection eyes. And Edwards is trying to describe what it's like, but he points out that we really can't even conceive of right now what that's like. It'd be like trying to describe a color that we've never seen or by, you know, like trying to tell somebody who doesn't know what color is, trying to describe to them what it is. They've never seen it. They have no point of reference. And even so, we really don't have a point of reference. We do know this. We do know that it will be glorious. Now again, the things that make heaven and the new world to come to be so glorious to us, that make it our greatest joy, are things that we don't fully understand, but we do understand partly. Remember, it's that which makes the Lord beautiful to us now. It's that which the Spirit of God showed us, that drew our hearts out to the Lord Jesus, that made us trust in Him, that made us follow Him, that made us seek after the kingdom of heaven, that make us want to go there. These are things that we do understand to some degree, but which unbelievers don't understand, can't understand, and really, because of that, don't appeal to them at all. They only appeal to us. And this is one of the ways that we can know that heaven actually belongs to us, because we want to be there. What we've just heard described is something that in our hearts we want. We want to be there. We want to see that. We want to see that glory. Edwards didn't go on to talk about what we're going to touch or what we're going to smell or what we're going to hear. He kind of focused on the eyes, but that is, as he said, the most glorious of things. But those are the things we want to experience, the things that have to do with the Lord. And the fact that we want to experience them means that the Lord has given us the desire and the taste for these things. We want the heaven that actually exists. Now, we do know that there are those who don't believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and who haven't really trusted Him savingly, but who think they want to go to heaven, right? They want to go at least to the heaven that they believe exists when they die, but they don't want to go to this heaven, because this heaven is only desirable to those who actually know the Lord, who have had their eyes opened to taste of these things. So this is one of the ways that we can know that we actually do belong to Him, is the fact that we want to go there. We want to go there for the right reasons, not to go fishing, you know, and always catch the biggest fish, not to go, you know, play sports where we always win, or some people say we gamble and we always win, we win all this money, not to go get all these material possessions, which some have characterized heaven as basically being a place where you get all these possessions, you get this grand mansion and everything in it and so forth, and that's why they want to go there, is because they think that what's precious on earth is going to be there and that somehow it has some value up there, but that's not the way it is. We want to be there for the right reasons. We want to be there because that's where the Lord is, the Father, the Lamb, the Spirit. Paul did not want to go to heaven because there wasn't enough gold on earth for him, okay? He wanted to go there to see God's glory. He wanted to be with the Lord Jesus Christ. That's the same thing that we're looking forward to. Richard Baxter summarizes all of that in this statement. He says, there's a great deal of difference between the desires of heaven in a sanctified man and an unsanctified. The believer prizes it above earth and had rather be with God than here, though death that stands in the way may possibly have harder thoughts from him. But to the ungodly, there is nothing seems more desirable than this world, and therefore he only chooses heaven before hell, but not before earth, and therefore shall not have it upon such a choice. So the question that this again reminds us of is this: Do you love heaven? And do you want to be in heaven for the same reason that Paul wanted to be in heaven? Well, if you do, then you're going to be there. You have it. It's yours if you're trusting Jesus. But let's not forget this point as well. The joy that you can have now in knowing that you will have it there won't be as strong as Paul's desire and his joy in this world, unless you put the kingdom of heaven first in the way that Paul put it first, unless you seek the kingdom the way he did. We need to be seeking the kingdom. We need to be yielding to the Spirit. We need to be going the right direction, submitting to the Lord if we are to have that same certainty and that same desire that the Apostle Paul had. And that's really the point of today. Do you want to have that exceedingly, that joy that is unspeakable or impossible to describe and full of glory, even in the middle of trials, is what we were looking at this morning. The only way you can have it is by putting the kingdom of heaven first, and that becomes a very strong motive to put the Lord first, that you might experience that fullness of joy, which the Lord wants you to experience. He's given you that promise. He's given you His Spirit. He's done all of these things so that you and I might experience that joy here and might, of course, experience the fullness of it in heaven. He wants us to have this joy, and the only thing that gets in our way is us, is because we're not willing to seek the kingdom the way He calls us to seek it. So let this be a motive to seek it in that way and to desire it in that way so that we might be able to experience the same thing that Paul did, that we won't be, when it comes time to leave, holding on to this world, but happy to let it go so that we can go to be with the Lord. Well, may the Lord help us to have that kind of spirit. Let's bow in a moment of prayer and let's ask the Lord to help us.